If you've gone to the beach lately and seen something that looks like it's flying over the surface of the water, you're not alone. It's called a hydrofoil, and over the past 10 years, they've gotten extremely popular. Whether on a sailboat, with a kite, windsurfer, wing, stand-up paddleboarding, or paddling prone into surf, it seems the hydrofoil revolution is here to stay, and how these hydrodynamic marvels actually work is fascinating and frequently misunderstood. The science behind hydrofoils is complicated. Most explanations on the internet are either incomplete or in some cases just completely wrong. I've taken fluid mechanics 3 times, once in undergrad, again while getting a master's in ocean engineering, and a 3rd time while getting a PhD in applied marine physics, and every time I took the course, I learned something new. In this video, I'm going to try to summarize everything I learned from those classes and my textbooks into a video that's relatively easy to understand and intuitive. First, we will explore an overview of hydrofoil kinematics, sort of like the big picture perspective of how hydrofoils work. After that, we'll dive into the fluid mechanics of hydrofoils and explain why water does what it does when interacting with these magical craft. If you're liking these videos and want to see more, please consider supporting us at waterlust.com. We make environmentally responsible apparel, including our brand new recycled sunshirts that are silk weight, UPF 50+, and perfect for foiling. Thank you so much for the support. Now, let's get back into the science. A hydrofoil craft typically is composed of 3 elements. At the bottom is an underwater wing, no different than the wing on an airplane except optimized for water, not air. At the top is some kind of payload, the place where the person goes. This can be a surfboard or a boat hull, or really anything that is meant to be lifted out of the water. In between the two is some kind of fuselage that mechanically connects the wing to the payload. An overview explanation of how hydrofoils work requires an understanding about how conventional boats work. If you haven't seen it already, check out our video on the physics of boats. We will be referencing some of the principles explained in that video, so pause now and take a look. We'll put a link to it in the description below. Any kind of conventional watercraft functions through the application of 3 forces. A force that holds everything up, prevents it from sinking, some kind of thrust that pushes the craft forward, and a resistance force, the friction created from moving the craft through the water. A conventional boat is held up by buoyancy, is driven forward by thrust from an engine, a sail, or some kind of human propulsion, and the resistance is created from plowing water out of the way at low speeds, or skimming over the surface of water at high speeds. At equilibrium, a boat's weight is equal to the buoyancy force it creates, and its thrust is equal to the resistance it produces. To go faster, one would need to add additional thrust, like mounting another engine on the back. Or it could go faster by reducing the resistance. This is what hydrofoils do. The underwater wing of a hydrofoil creates an upward force that lifts the payload above the water's surface. This reduces the hydrodynamic resistance of the craft substantially because the payload is no longer creating divergent or transverse waves, and the friction produced between the craft and the water is nearly eliminated because the wetted surface area becomes so small. That upward lift is created by efficiently deflecting water downward, resulting in an equal and opposite force upward. Similar in principle to how a drone flies by accelerating air downward. So in summary, hydrofoils have an underwater wing that efficiently deflects water downward, lifts the payload above the water, which gets rid of the waves and reduces the friction, which allows the craft to go way faster. Easy, right? But how does all that happen? To understand that, we need to look closely at what water is and how it behaves. Water is a liquid that is composed of a sea of small molecules that are packed closely together. Unlike a solid, though, where these molecules are locked in place, in a liquid, they are free to move around while rubbing up against each other and colliding into one another, like individual cars flowing in a sea of rush hour traffic. In gases, neighboring molecules can get farther apart or closer together, but in liquids, like water, the molecules stay more or less the same distance apart, held together by intermolecular bonds. If we consider a single water molecule as a cube in the Cartesian coordinate system, it will experience forces from its neighbors on all 6 sides. The sum of those forces divided by the area in which they are applied is called the pressure. It's important to note that water pressure can never be negative, but you can have areas with higher pressure or lower pressure. Because water molecules can move freely and they experience forces from neighbors on all six sides, water, like all liquids, cannot maintain its own shape and will fill the space it is provided. To illustrate, if you carefully stack solid materials on top of one another, they can stay stacked. But if you stack liquid material on top of one another, they will always fall and rearrange themselves into the shape of the container holding them. This is a subtle but important point when considering the flow of water around a hydrofoil. If we look at a side view of a foil angled to incoming water, it's instructive to consider the upper and lower side with an imaginary dotted line. If there was no foil present, the water on both sides would just flow straight back and nothing would happen. But with the foil present, water molecules on the lower side get physically deflected down by the foil, which is in a way intuitive. It's like a physical barrier that diverts some of the lanes of a highway. If you don't turn, you hit the guardrail, which forces you to turn. The molecules on the upper side follow along the surface of the foil. But what do they do when the foil bends away? Shouldn't the water molecules just go straight back, leaving a void of space? Well, the answer is no, because water always fills the space it is provided. If we use our traffic metaphor, this is like all of a sudden having new uncrowded lanes open up beside you. What happens? People drive into the new lanes until they're filled. At the molecular level, water molecules move into these new spaces because they have crowded neighbors pushing them more on one side than the other, which results in a net force in the direction that fills the new space. So now we have a general description of how the motion of water around a foil works, but how does that create forces that lift boats out of the water? To understand that, let's examine the interplay between velocity and pressure in water. To keep with our traffic metaphor, let's imagine five lanes of traffic getting split up such that the lower three lanes are forced downward, while the top two lanes are free to go wherever they want. What happens to the relative speeds of the cars? It's intuitive that the cars that have more lanes to accelerate into will go faster than the cars that are being redirected. And with the flow over a foil, that's exactly what happens. Water over the lower surface is redirected, causing the equivalent of a traffic jam, whereas water over the upper surface is provided more space to occupy and accelerate into. This explains the difference in flow velocity between the two sides of a foil. But what about the pressure? One of the biggest misunderstandings people have when trying to explain how foils work is the idea of one-way causality between velocity and pressure. Or in other words, that pressure somehow creates the velocity, or conversely, that the velocity somehow creates the pressure. In reality, pressure and velocity in a fluid exist as a reciprocal cause and effect relationship. Neither would exist without the other. To illustrate how this works, try pushing some heavy boxes over the floor. Because there is a lot of resistance, the boxes don't accelerate much, and the pressure on your hand is maintained. But if you take the same boxes and put them on wheels, the resistance is substantially reduced. The boxes accelerate in response to your applied force, and less pressure is maintained on your hand. If we think of water molecules as tiny boxes, this is exactly what happens. If a water molecule is free to accelerate in response to the forces applied by its neighbors, then its velocity will increase simultaneously as the pressure decreases. Or, on the flip side, if a water molecule is unable to accelerate in response to an applied force, like if it's stuck in a traffic jam, then higher pressure is maintained simultaneously with the lower velocity. This effect in fluids is so significant, it has a special name. It's called Bernoulli's principle, named after the Swiss mathematician and physicist Daniel Bernoulli. It states that an increase in the speed of a fluid occurs simultaneously with a decrease in static pressure. If we put all of these ideas together on a hydrofoil, the water that flows over the lower surface is like the cars in our example getting diverted downward. The resulting traffic jam creates low speeds, which in turn maintain high pressure. The water over the upper surface is like cars that suddenly have more lanes. They accelerate into the new space, which simultaneously reduces the pressure. These different molecular traffic patterns result in higher pressure on the lower side of the foil and smaller pressure on the upper side. And the difference in the two pressures results in an upward force that lifts a hydrofoil out of the water, which again reduces the hydrodynamic resistance by eliminating waves and reducing wetted surface, allowing the craft to accelerate faster and faster.
And that's it.
I hope you enjoyed this video. I tried to make it as easy to understand without getting too bogged down in the math, and there's a lot of math in the field of fluid mechanics. But hey, math is awesome, and if you want to take a deeper dive, I have three books that you might want to check out. The first is Understanding Aerodynamics, Arguing from the Real Physics by Doug McLean. He was a professional engineer in the aerodynamics field, and I find this book is the most intuitive, easy to read, technically accurate text without getting super, super bogged down in calculus. I highly, highly recommend it for people that are interested in understanding how aerodynamics and hydrodynamics work. The next is definitely a more complicated book, Hydrodynamics of High-Speed Marine Vehicles by Odd M. Faltinson. This is the most specific book I've ever found that gets into the nitty-gritty details of the hydrodynamics of high-speed marine craft, like boats and hydrofoils. It has a lot of math in it, but don't be afraid. It's really, really detailed, and it covers everything you would ever want to know about it. And then finally, sort of the gold standard for fluid mechanics textbooks is Kundu and Cohen. In this book, it's really, really thick. They teach it generally in undergraduate education courses, and it gives you an overview of absolutely everything in fluid mechanics. So if you want to take a deeper dive, definitely check out those three texts, and thank you so much for watching.